So it's a bit funny, like I'm borrowing skills from other people, but why not? Learning, and I hope it won't hurt too much.
That's what open source is about.
Sorry?
It's what open source is about.
Hurting people?
No.
Okay. I didn't remember this decision. So I'll slowly start with that one. So yeah, welcome to my talk. My name is Angel Bertini, and I'm the author of a website, CoreCamus.com, which is about reverse engineering and visual documentations. And it all started more or less because of that tweet by a friend where he challenged me to make a JPEG and you encrypt it and you get a valid JPEG. The thing is, both format, JPEG, both thing, monsters, JPEG and AES are not known to be easy to understand to everybody. And this is the interesting part here. No need to know AES or JPEG because they are too complex anyway. So I'll just explain let's play just with Lego blocks and keep it simple, understandable, and just see what we need to know to actually solve the challenge. It was not a real challenge, like a CTF challenge. He didn't know that could be done. At the time, I didn't think that could be done. But in the end, it's not so hard. You'll just see after those 120 slides. So first, I'll introduce crypto and a binary lightly, just enough so that we can understand. Then have a better look, progressive look at the challenge. And then go through a walkthrough example, because apparently that was already a bit too hard. And then since my previous slide deck on the topic, I extended the method. So hidden appended data, improving zip compatibility, and a derivative of what became called as encryption. So first, block crypto basics as a very easy level, because I really knew nothing about crypto, or almost nothing about crypto, back in January. So very easy. AES is a block cipher. That triple death, blowfish, and from now on, we'll say AES 128, just in the name of AES. And a block cipher takes a block of data of fixed size, which is called block size. So it's 16 bytes for AES. And if the block is smaller, then it's padded. Then a key as input, and it messes around the block with the key. And that's all it does. Now, we don't need to actually go deep in the actual behavior of AES. So an example, a key, a block, and the result, yeah, whatever. If you do a slight change on the key, you get a completely different result. And if you do a slight change on the block, you get, another time, a completely different result. So basically, with a tiny change in the key or the input block, the output block is different. It's completely different, which means we can't control the output because the differences are unpredictable. So usually that you could already see that anything that has to do with crypto in general, the output is cannot be controlled. So that was already why the challenge looks scary to me. Oh, sneaky. So there's a reverse operation, hopefully. And to get back the original block with reverse operation and the same key. So the decryption. So encrypt, then decrypt. So typically what is about to be encrypted is what you can understand, read, and that's called the plain text. And what you get is the ciphertext. And this is after the output of AES. So in this case, you'll get something that is usually not understandable, except that it can be reverted back to the plain text. So plain text encrypted into ciphertext, and ciphertext decrypted into plain text. That's all we need to know for now. So we take a block, we encrypt, we get something that looks random. But if we take the same key, we take this output and we take the same key, we actually get the original block. That's good. That's why it's helpful, because otherwise that would be a bit annoying. But if we slightly change the key, we get some completely different result. So basically, once we decrypt, well, that's our point of view, our limited point of view. We can't decrypt if we don't have the key used to encrypt. Okay, well, cryptographer might argue, but it's not my level of things here. So now, that's all we need to know for crypto so far. Now let's look at file formats once again at a very easy level. So First, there are the file formats, the system formats, and those are really complex because they depend on the architecture, they depend on CPU. But the file formats that you see in standard tools have, they are less complex, and they depend on the specs only. So all those formats, ZIP, RAR, JPEG, PNG, GIF, and so on. So they are less complex, because actually, at least there is no electronic rules there behind. It's just human stupidity. So it should be better. But actually, it's not that bad. So typically, those formats start with a magic signature. So a fixed byte sequence, more or less long, and it's enforced at offset zero. So the use is that at least you look at offset zero, and if you have this signature, then it might be the file format you expected. If it's not, then the file is invalid, period. And there could be collisions, but there are very few. So just an example, if you start with a Cafe Bay but offset zero, then it's both universal Mako and Java class, but the recent Mako, it chose a different signature. So 32-bit and 64-bit. So collisions are very rare. There are still enough people to not to fight too much about magic signature, enforced at offset zero. Very easy way to identify most file formats. Then the substructures of the file format, they are made of chunks. So chunks have different name depending on the actual format spec, but it doesn't matter. It's just substructure. So they are called chunk, segment, atom. And typically the structure of a chunk is type, length, value. So you have a type identifier. And once again, it's called marker, type, ID. Then the length of the chunk, the data itself, and sometimes some extra data such as the checksum of the chunk data. So many file formats, they are made of chunks. And actually, you can more or less move those chunks around a bit without the need to understand what's happening. The use of chunks is that newer chunk type can be ignored by older files, by older tools, so that they can still render or handle most of the file, without, even though they don't handle the latest functionalities. And then tools can also create their own custom chunks to store their internal information while still being standard. And the files can still be opened by the other software following the chunks. I'm surprised he didn't really laugh yet, but it's going to happen probably. So very simple example of chunk structure. So the file starts with the magic signature, then the set of chunks, and typically header. The important ones are data and end chunk, and then some extra chunk that are not necessary, like command, thumbnail, metadata. This thing you can imagine as extra, not required. And the rest is, if there is no header, data, or end, then the file is likely invalid. So the end of the file is usually defined by an end chunk itself. So this chunk is not just a signature, but it's really a chunk itself, even though it's specified, for example, to have, like in the case of PNG, have no data. So the length is zero, the chunk type is encoded, and the CRC of the empty data is there. So to finish a PNG image, you theoretically need an image end chunk to say, this is the end of my file. So after what is in the end chunk, after the official end of the file, you can put some data. And most file format tolerates any data of any length after this end marker. This will be very helpful in the end. It's not always so trivial, but at least you have a valid file, you append whatever, it's still valid because the start of the file was valid until the end marker. So for example, very few exceptions, the Java class and Java archive, you output a single byte at the end of the file, the file will refuse to load. Like foreign data detected, I don't want to load that. Wow. When did you know that Java was so strict? That's probably the only thing it's strict at. But still, that was quite unexpected when you think about it. Even in the case of zip, you create a zip of Java classes, you add an extra byte, reject it. Whoa, Java is so cool. So to summarize about a valid binary file in most standard formats, you have a valid header with a valid, that's after a valid magic, the valid chunk structure, and an end chunk, and possibly any data if the file is actually tolerated. But that's outside the file format. But usually that's tolerated, completely accepted in practice. So now let's go back to the challenge. We have basics of crypto and basics of binary at a very high level, but that's all we need for now. So it was about encrypting a JPEG into a valid JPEG. So now, even if we still haven't seen what a JPEG is actually, we know that the encryption will completely mess. And yeah, of course, JPEG, but then why not extending it to other file formats? So we know that after a block cipher went through, this would be random. So the signature that had to be there will be completely random, and the data will become random. And you know that we somehow expect a signature, chunk structure, and marker. And then that's gone. It doesn't look really possible. And when I heard that as a challenge, I was like, nah, we can't control the output of AES. Well, turns out I was wrong. So I said that AES is a block cipher, so it works on a block. How does it work on a file? Because a file is usually bigger than 16 bytes. Many files are actually bigger than 16 bytes. So because AES works with blocks, and if key and plain text are the same, then the ciphertext is the same, which means if we apply just the cipher on each block, identical blocks will give identical output. This is a big weakness that is used in the electronic codebook mode. This is a encryption mode that is only for studying, and this is absolute shit for security. Judge for yourself, it doesn't look terribly encrypted. If you can't recognize, then maybe there's a problem. The encryption is too strong. And that's why it's a major failure when Adobe actually used it to encrypt the password. Well, they didn't hash password, they used this tool. So that's high-level encryption. Good job, guys. So basically, other modes, better modes, were introduced so that each block encryption operation on each block is chained so that the difference from the start of the file will propagate on the whole encryption of the file. So basically, a single change at the start of the file will eventually have the consequences on the full encryption until the end of the file, so that no part of the file can be recovered, and the result of the whole file, even though it's just a block cipher, will be unpredictable. And for that, they introduce other parameters like initialization vector or nonce. So a number you use only once, number once. So those modes introduce an extra parameter. So now let's look at the ones using initialization vector. So this parameter can be arbitrarily chosen, but in practice it should be unpredictable. Like often it's a repetitive hash or something of the file, so that you cannot, if you didn't have the original file, you cannot get it or something. So in practice it should be unpredictable, but at least you can freely choose it. And let's look at how it works on a cipher block chaining mode. So the first plaintext block is XORed with the IV, and then this is encrypted via AES, the block, in the block operation, with the key, and you get C1. The result is XORed on P2, and so on. So this chains the result of here, this modifies the rest, and so on. So it changes from the first block, from first plaintext block, to the result of the last ciphertext block. So here we have C1 is the encryption of the IV XORed with P1. So basically, if we go back, if we decrypt C1, we get IV XOR P1. So we know it from the file, the source file, this we know it from the target file. So we choose the key arbitrarily once for all. Then we decrypt, we have this, we XOR, and we have an IV. Now we have an IV so that when we encrypt it, we get the C1 we get. So this is a case where it's not really controlling the output of AES, but AES CBC, we can choose the IV so that we get the right C1 we want. Of course, after this, randomness again, but at least we can instantly determine the IV so that this will encrypt to what we wanted. So no matter the key or block cipher, for a given P1 C1, we can craft an initialization vector so that the start of the file, the first block, will be encrypted into the file starting with what we wanted as a first block, with IV's decryption, XOR P1. So, simple example, we choose our own key, whatever, and we determine this key, so that this PDF signature encrypts as a ping signature. So now we control the output not of AES, but of AES CBC via the initialization vector. So we control the first block. Woohoo! And that's, yeah, something I didn't know. So now the challenge looks not completely impossible. And but the following blocks supposedly still look random. So let's look back again at encryption. Because what is plain text? Plain text is usually what we know, and ciphertext is what we don't control, but we know that we can write back. But that's just wrong concept. The two operations are just opposite operations, and they don't really care what if ciphertext is German or French, and they just do their operation, and you know that when you do one operation, the reverse can undo the changes. So basically, they take any input, give the result, and the result just gives you back what you wanted, what you had originally. So basically, if you take a key and a block of text and you decrypt the plain text, it doesn't really make sense to in practice to decrypt the plain text, but it still gives you random. But in this case, when you re-encrypt that, you get back your block of text. So you cheat in advance, knowing that, okay, I want not to control the block, but I want to control the block output, so I decrypt my block in advance, so that when I encrypt it, I get what I wanted. So you can decrypt plain text, it gives you back your plain text after re-encryption, so you can control some AES output. So if we add plain text to our encrypted file, we get this. So we encrypt our penguin, we add the devil, then we decrypt that, we get penguin appended with some garbage, but when we encrypt this, we get here what we wanted. And now you see that this is for the image appended data, and this is something you actually control. So since AJIC junk at the end of a file makes it valid, we add decrypted plain text, and that will encrypt to what we want. So combining the fact that binary file story rate appended data, and that you can decrypt plain text so that you can control the output of encryption. So we control the first block, we control some appended data, but what about the text that was encrypted? How do we control the encrypted data from the source file, so from the original file that we have set? What do we do with this? How do we control? But well, we just don't. We just mess with the file format. We politely ask the file format to ignore it. So we will just mess with the file format to just say, okay, now ignore all this garbage that is coming next. And after the end of the garbage, here is my, what's the name? The devil, the FreeBSD. What's the name of the FreeBSD devil?
It's Chuck.
Chuck?
Chuck.
Really? Okay, well, maybe
beastie.
Sorry?
It has
beastie.
Different names.
Yeah, beastie.
Yeah.
Okay. So our current challenge is within the block, because that's what we can control on both sides, get a valid header and chunk start. And now this is specific to each target format. So just to show you in a very high level things, so this is the whole block size, and we want the source file to have the signature, the required signature. So with the IV trick, we will control both of these. Here we have the tux image. Here we have the decrypted beastie. And when this will encrypt, we get some random stuff. But we just mess with the format so that this will start a chunk that will be ignored. And here our decrypted beastie will get normal back. And then we'll have a normal image in that case, in the case of those two pictures. So let's look at PDF. We'll keep the real PDF for the next talk, so let's keep it easy and succinct. Kurt, wait. Someone hold him. So, from a very simple PDF point of view, PDF just has a small signature. It's made of objects, and stream objects can contain any data. That's really good. That's what we want. So we just create a stream object, no matter the standard, and then we can put our garbage, our encrypted block, and the PDF will be more or less happy. So, in a very short example, so here we have the stream object, and whatever is inside doesn't really matter. We could put anything, the address of home site lab, for example. It wouldn't matter. The PDF would still be valid from a high level point of view. So, the declaration is that we have a number, So for the stream object, we have a number, another number, object, some parameters between angle brackets, the stream keyword, the data, so our AES blocks will be here, and then we will have the end stream and object keyword. The problem is that this takes more than 30 bytes, and we need all this to shrink into 16 bytes or less. Otherwise, we will require some heavy brute forcing. Hopefully, PDF is not so strict, so let's first truncate the signature. This is not a valid signature, but it works with all readers. Then we just remove the object number entirely, and we don't need parameters. And with extreme luck, this takes exactly 16 bytes. So percentage PDF dash zero character, null character, while you're not supposed to, you're still supposed to put this whole signature, stream, and then you can start your actual, put any data you have. So this is the first cipher block. You encrypt to that, you have your garbage block, and then you put back your original data from the original, from the source file. So, and even better, it doesn't really matter if we already have a signature, because we will have a signature, then we might have, if we encrypt a PDF into another PDF, we will end up with two PDF signatures. It doesn't matter. So here, and there's an example on my slides, which were a PDF, an executable, an HTML, all together, in the same file, that was presented last year at 44Con. And you have HTML finishing here, and the PDF starting right after. And the HTML is actually, as you see, in the PDF object, in a stream, the object in PDF. So very easy to, now that we can put this header and object start into 16 bytes, we can control, we can put any data we want. So the steps, just to summarize for PDF, we choose our key. Okay, easy. Now we choose our files. Then we know if the target file will be a PDF, that or the first cipher block will be strictly like this. With this, by decrypting this with the key and XORing with the source first block, we get the initialization vector. So we encrypt the source file. We append the termination object here. We put back, we append the target file, which is the rest of the whole PDF file. We decrypt this, and then we get a file that actually, so we can get a PDF that encrypts as another PDF. So I did a POC, and all the POCs are available on my website. So even Adobe Reader, so yet. So let's look at JPEG. JPEG, that was the origin of the JPEG is even worse than all the other formats. So that's why it's really good that we just ignore all of this, because it's really complex. So JPEG, very short signature, chunk structure, nothing special. And for example, to start a chunk ID, we need just those 2 bytes. So then we now have the length of the data we'll put and the data itself. So we just need FFD8 for the signature, FFFE, and the length. We don't even really need, we will see later, we can even have a more or less arbitrary length. So we need very few bytes to actually start random data inside something that could still be seen as a JPEG. So get the original size, because here, unlike PDF, we have to tell in advance the size of garbage we want to put in. So we get the original size with the padding. Then our first cipher block will be this, and the padding, or we could even start put some whatever we want. Then generate the initialization vector and encrypt everything and do the same again, append the target file and decrypt the rest. The thing is, here it's, if you remember, AES block size is 16, but all the block ciphers like DES, triple DES have a block size of 8, and you can use a DES, triple DES with, for example, to encrypt as a JPEG. So it'll be the same, another POC. So this encrypts, this available again available on my website. So it works. And ping is just a bit harder than JPEG in this case. So the signature is big. The chunk data, this time the length is stored on 4 bytes, so we can put bigger data because the other JPEG was on 2 bytes, so it was a bit limiting. And very luckily, the signature and the whole chunk declaration are 16 bytes. So again, I was very lucky. One byte more, I would need some brute forcing. Here it's really instant. I have my script on my website is you give the PDF, you give the ping, it's instant. And it should work. There shouldn't be any failure. Like there's no random parameter, except if the PDF reader is suddenly strict. My God, hopefully that doesn't happen. So encrypt as a ping, more or less the same thing as a JPEG, except that once you encrypted the stuff, you need to get the checksum of the original data once encrypted. You put the checksum, and then you put the rest of the chunks from the from the target file, and you will get actually your file that encrypts as a ping. So here, this was actually my first example. So you have the signature, then the chunk length, the chunk type, so you can choose more or less any chunk type you want, the encrypted data of the duck, and then the chunk coming from this once encrypted. Then you put back the original chunk of the target file, the target ping file. So another POC available once again on my website. I thought it was nice to encrypt RSA as NSA. And yeah, I just went further, flash video. This time it's even more permissive. There's no real challenge. Then you have the size. You can put whatever we want. You just say, here is where my data would put. There's no checksum, no trick at this stage. Just another POC. Nothing really complex. But it's just that it's not strictly. It's more like I didn't experiment with other file formats. But on the other hand, usually people don't experiment with videos, so file format, and there's no reason file videos should be smarter than other file formats. So yeah, let's encrypt the video into another one. So initially we were looking at Andreas Box and Yan Chen. I asked how should we call that, and we came up with very encryption agnostic, idempotent, cryptoquine, endomorphism, and Yan Chen was like, fuck it, let's call it encryption. And we all agreed that cryptoquine, encryption. So if you're looking for a nice word, just Yorchenize it as Yan Chen. So this is not specific to AES, just block cipher in general. This is not specific to CBC, as long as you have the IV or the initialized event vector or the way to control the output. And so you just need to control the first cipher block. The source format should tolerate appended data. And then within the block size, you should fit header and the chunk declaration. And also the source file should be not too big. In the case of JPEG, it's stored on 2 bytes so that it can fit into one chunk. In the other case, it might be more complex. Actually, I have a bit more complex case coming next. But this is not specific to those file formats or to AES. So as a consequence, you can even change that. And we did that. So you could have the same file, and the one appended data block will encrypt as a ping, one appended data will encrypt as a JPEG, and so on. You could change that together. You can crypt or decrypt. Why not? Or you can use a different cipher, or you could even use a different mode, like not necessarily CBC. So it's just as long as you want to more or less avoid some brute forcing, and the file format tolerates the requirements. I agree with the requirements that you need. So I was asked for a step-by-step walkthrough because apparently that was a bit, remember that was initially explained in like 6 slides? They suffered that day. That wasn't recorded, I wonder why. So let's take this. So it's a minimum zip containing a hello world text. I wrote those files by hand in assembly, if you're not familiar with my work. And into this. This is a ping file. So this time it's a real ping file. It has all this not strictly required chunks, physical, time, background, whatever. So it's a real ping file. And feel free to guess what this means. It's not very difficult, but yeah, you might need the disassembler. So just to see what we want to encrypt the zip as a ping. Zip tolerates appended data. It's not entirely true, but it works in this case. Our source file is 128 bytes and we'll encrypt with AES. AES is a 16 bytes block cipher. So we will pad The part, yeah, this is rounded with 16. This is rounded to 16 by some coincidence. Okay. So, because of the PKCS7 padding, there will still be a line of padding that will be added at the end. It's not because, oh, it's rounded, so let's add nothing, but something will be added for the padding. Doesn't make any difference, but it's just so that we know why it will happen like this. So the first block of our source file is this. Okay. And, the target format is a ping. So we need to start with the signature. Then we have the chunk length. We said that the source file was 128 plus padding. And already 16 bytes are covered in the first cipher block. So our dummy block that's coming next will be 128 block long, bytes long. And this is encoded because ping is Little Indian. This is encoded like this. And then we need to come up with a chunk type. It doesn't matter. So the chunk, if the chunk type starts with the lowercase, this is not so critical. So basically you can call it anything. We could use text or AAA or whatever. So the first cipher block of our ping will be the signature of 8 bytes, the length, and our AAA block. That's our first block. And this starts a valid ping with a dummy chunk. So then we use a secret key, whatever. Now we know that our first cipher block is this. So we decrypt the cipher block. And then with the original plaintext block from the zip and the cipher block, by XORing them, we get the initialization vector. So now we have our initialization vector. All the parameters for encryption are determined. So we will encrypt the zip, and it will have the right ping header and chunk start that we expected, that we wanted. So now we pad source file, we said that already. Then we encrypt the data of the source file, and we will get this chunk, this checksum in this case. We append this checksum at the end of our dummy chunk, and then we append all the rest of the target file minus the signature, because the signature is already at the start. Then there is a dummy chunk, then there are all the real chunks of the file, and our target file is now a valid ping. So if we go back, we have the zip file here, the padding, and the decrypted content of the target file. So this is a zip with some appended data, whatever it is. This is a valid zip. And in this case, it really starts with the original file, so you know it will work. And here, this will decrypt to, here we have the signature, the dummy. Should I zoom? Can you see things? Actually, yeah. Oops. So we have the ping signature, the chunk declaration, the encrypted content of the source file, the checksum calculated from this, and then the rest of the chunks from the source file, from the target file, that were decrypted in advance and now, once encrypted, get back to their original content. So it starts the target file, some dummy chunk, and the original file, and then some padding that could be, may not be here, but yeah, it's here, it doesn't hurt. So I know what you think, that was probably too easy. So let's look for a more elegant solution. Just because this is a bit of a giveaway, like this, you have the dummy chunk at the beginning, and this you have the completely standard file, then this big appended data. So because we have to handle the specific structure of each format, we could actually go further and manipulate even the source file a bit. So both files are in standard, so it's not really stealthy or smart or elegant, depends on your point of view. So I try to come with a smarter appended data, and anyway, we have to handle the file formats. So why not? Let's do it even with the source file. So basically, instead of hiding the external data after the whole file, after the end chunk, why not combining it inside in the data chunk? And then we'll combine in a more advanced way encryption and decryption blocks. So basically, initially we were doing that. We had the original file and we had just add the appended data, okay? But actually, with some studying, we know that the original file is made of the header, the specific data, and the footer. Because we know that, then we can actually go be smarter and put the appended data inside the file format at the data chunk, at chunk level. So it really looks like much more like a normal file. Luckily, it works. So if you just take a small pin chunk handler and you just open the file, and once you have the chunk that is the image data, you had 1 megabyte of garbage, both files still work, even if one was the original one, and one contains a lot of shit. Basically, the decryptor just looks for the data it wanted, and it doesn't care if there is appended data at chunk level. Yeah, it will discard this without any problem. And it's actually the case with many file formats. So in this case, we also need to extend the encryption decryption trick. And if you remember, with the block operations, when you decrypt blocks one after each other, you have a state at this moment, and then whatever you put just depends on what was put before. So then, if you encrypt this and you append some data, you decrypt the whole stuff, you put some data, you can actually get some data that you can have some encrypted data that will encrypt to whatever, but you append some data you want, you decrypt the whole stuff, you append, and then in the end, this block will encrypt to this block. And in both blocks, you have much more blocks you control. It's not limited to one pass. You can really chain that. And I don't know if you had this broadcast, this quiz in Germany where the people were sending each other the question and so on. It was popular in France. It's very, okay. It reminded me of a quiz where people can send each other the questions, but apparently your face, it doesn't exist. It still runs in France for like 20 years. Okay. Going for gold, it's called. Okay, so I call it the going for gold block mode, because you put some stuff, you send it to the other one, he puts another stuff, and then it goes back, and in the end you control some data here, you control some data here, and this data that you don't control at this level, once encrypted, it will be what you wanted. So now we can extend the same thing as earlier, but instead of putting it everything, we have the source data, that's the original file, then we put our data. Well, it was here, and we get it decrypted inside the chunk, and then this is the end of our chunk with the end of this file, and so this will encrypt, this will be random again, but we just have a dummy chunk declaration that will just stop in the middle, so that this is the actual original file. So in this case, the advantage is that the source file it has extra data in one of its chunk, but from a file format perspective, if you just parse and not interpret, like you parse the writing but not interpret the meaning, then this is a fully standard file. So I made an example. So you have some garbage. With the decoy key, you will get to carry beer. And with the actual RAID key, this file looks like a standard ping file. Then you will get a beer adapter. So, and this is the result. This is the carry beer. And you have nothing after, you just have three chunks. And inside this chunk, there is the data of the carry beer and the decrypted data of the hidden image. So it's just a bit advanced. Another thing, a friend of mine, Axel April, not to name her, was interested in encrypting ping to APK, so Android zips. And then, usually, we just think that you can put whatever you want. Zip is extremely permissive, but actually, that's wrong. And in this case, we needed to actually do something against that. So, zip file in structure, zip file in practice, zip file signature is not enforced at offset zero. So basically, usually people think that put the zip wherever you want, it will be fine. And that's actually wrong. Zip is not like the other formats, for example, RAR, enforce the signature at offset zero. But zip doesn't. But it's still not a reason to work from anywhere in the file. So the zip is actually passed backward, because at the time it was compressed on the fly by putting floppies in your drive. So the header was written last, even on the last floppy. The start of the data could be written on one floppy, and the header of the file, of the whole archive, was spanning over several floppies and was written on the last floppy. So basically, the start of the zip is at the end. So it's passed from this to the end. So when it's the end of the file, that's fine. But if you put some append data, actually, many, or I think all tools, have a threshold of how much append data they tolerate. And if you put too much append data, they will fail scanning the file backward because they won't see the end of centralized directory record, nice name, and they will fail to see the actual zip contained at the start of the file. So you take a zip, if it's not at the start of the file and if there's a lot of append data, then it might just give up finding the actual PDF structure. Kurt is asleep, I think. Kurt is faking to be awake, I think. So the trick is to actually, you have this structure, why not just duplicate it after the append data? It's actually very small, so you just take the file, you have your append data, you just locate this, you copy it again and you adjust the offset, and it would be fine. So this way, it solved the problem, and we had, she mentioned it. Yeah, so basically, she mentioned it in her talk, when was it? Yesterday? Yeah, yesterday, something. So to encrypt a ping as Android APK, so a covert way to store APK if you want. But basically, without that, the APK was not standard enough because, the EOC, the end of central directory, was out of reach, like in this case. Then my friend Kinfail Colwin suggested that because JPEG only requires 4 bytes, why not retrospectively be less smart and just brute force the key, which is right. So basically, you just need the file signature of 2 bytes and the chunk declaration of 4 bytes. You just need to brute force until you get your original plaintext block. You brute force the key until the first cipher block starts with this. It took the 18 million iterations for me. So then you have a start of the file that has the right value. The chunk size will be random, but you just need, it's not too big because it's stored on 2 bytes. So you just need to put your data at the right offset. And if by any chance, which was my case, the source file was too big, then you recompress with higher compression with JPEG. And then it fits. So some brute forcing required. That was probably easier. I didn't need to know the block cipher mode. But then this presentation would have been much, much smaller and you would have been sad, I'm sure. So another POC, so that's Ginfail, and it encrypts at the ECB mode, but that's just a joke. But yeah, this JPEG via ECB mode. I usually consider that ECB is not a real encryption mode, while CBC is considered fully secure when the initialization vector is unpredictable. This is not a fake encryption mode that was built just for my presentation. This is fully secure for to crypto standards. So while EBC is a joke just for students, to teach students, so CBC is actually the real thing, crypto-wise. So no, not much difference, just instead of crafting the initialization vector, brute forcing things. So sources and proofs of concepts all available on this URL of my website. Yeah, it's still a subversion. I always use Git, but for Cork and me, I have some kind of nostalgia. I'm going to revert to CVS soon, don't worry. So it was just a funny trick, which was combining crypto magic and binary magic. But usually those topics are scary, especially in the case of JPEG, like JPEG, manipulating JPEG data, okay, no. Controlling AES, never mind. So it was actually, you don't need to understand the whole detail to actually be able to magically combine them. And usually it's true that I think some application encrypts stuff so that to assume that the attacker has just lost control over what will be stored, like Adobe encrypting password in ECB mode, obviously. And okay, this has a few steganographic applications. And this is good. Crypto is not always random. So if you want to protect yourself, be careful with that. And good news, you don't need to understand fully crypto and binary to be able to manipulate. And maybe there will be some application that I didn't look at yet for crypto protocols. Could be fun, like to turn a protocol into another one, like a crypto protocol polyglot. But I didn't start playing with protocol polyglots yet. That's probably the reason why. But later, who knows? If you have any suggestions, I'm open. Well, if it's not just something unchallenging like the Flash version or some application and sometimes enforcing consequences. Now, I'm sure there would be some CTF flags where there would be some encryption, and then the result of the encrypted stuff will be parsed in a way or another. But this is not new, but at least it's not so hard. A big thanks to Jean-Philippe Aumasson, who helped me a lot for all the crypto stuff, and all those guys. Thanks a lot, and thanks for your attention.